Healthcare is a very complex and important issue here in Washington. Care providers are facing many urgent challenges, and legislators will need to act during the legislative session. You're listening to The Elephant in the Dome. This is the official podcast of the Washington Senate Republican Caucus. I'm Tracy Ellis, and with me is Senator Ron Muzzall. He's on the Senate Health and Long-Term Care Committee. So, Senator, I know this is a tough one because this is such a complex issue, but what's the most pressing healthcare problem the legislature should take up in 2023?
Well, yeah, you are so correct, Tracy. This is I've been on, this will be my fourth session on health and long-term care, and I believe I was ranking last year and possibly the year before, but we've been digging into all of the problems that are involved in healthcare. And COVID exacerbated a bunch of those, made them worse. So the one thing that's risen to the top over the last year or two, specifically since the midst of COVID, let's say late 20, early 21, has been access. So if you divide up healthcare into all the different areas, we're talking behavioral health, substance abuse, physical care, both as primary physicians, but also hospitals, and then long-term care, assisted care, that type of thing. If you spread it out over all of those areas, access is by far the biggest challenge. So finding a doctor, finding a hospital that can take you in an emergency at times, or for elective care, finding providers, finding a long-term care facility that can take a patient who needs to be discharged from a hospital. All of these fall under this access network, which is really challenged right now. And it's challenged both availability of rooms, but those rooms are affected by the providers, be they nurses, skilled nursing, whatever the case. We've got a shortage of healthcare workers out there as well. And but if you pull all of this back, what is the number one cause of this? More often than not, it's Medicaid shortfall.
Dig in a little bit more to that. Some people may not understand why Medicaid plays such a huge role in this.
Yeah, so Medicaid is the state portion. There's federal matching dollars, FMAP, federal medical assistance percentage, that goes into those Medicaid dollars. But Medicaid is the state-funded program for disadvantaged, low-income constituents. You've got Medicare. That takes place post-retirement. You've got other different kinds of federal payments for medical, Indian Health, for instance. But Medicaid takes those individuals under, not in an ethnic group necessarily, under an age, and it provides care for them. Typically, about 500,000 residents in the state of Washington received some sort of Medicaid coverage. And that was, like I say, could fall in any of those areas: long-term care, primary physicians, hospital stays. Since COVID, that number has grown to about 800,000. And it's a huge part of our state budget every year, but it has grown during the COVID, during the pandemic, because federal mandates did not allow the state to control those rules. You couldn't move somebody out of Medicaid because of those federal mandates. So it's grown about 60%, from 500,000 to 800,000 individuals are currently on that. The way it currently stands, that was supposed to end the end of January. They were supposed to tell us 60 days prior to it ending if it was going to end. So we now believe that then will go on to, well, February, March, April. So it'll be the 1st of May before the state would begin to look at how they could adjust the numbers on those roles. But that's just kind of a side note. The reality of life is that Washington State has not addressed some of those Medicaid reimbursement rates for 20 years. And currently, we rank number 50 in the United States when it comes to federal matching dollars. In other words, if we would raise those Medicaid rates, we would get more matching dollars. And so there have been some that we haven't addressed in 20 years, some we haven't addressed in 10 years. So what has transpired is, and these are two-year-old numbers at least, but let's take long-term care. We were $45 a day less than Idaho and $135 a day less than Oregon. And we had much higher minimum wage than Idaho, for instance. So a long-term care facility that is receiving Medicaid dollars for a patient, they're going behind. An individual that can't be discharged out of a hospital because they've got to go to a long-term care and there's no or rehab facility, there's none available, they're receiving Medicaid rates in the neighborhood of $350 a day. And the cost of the hospital is closer to $600.
Okay, I'm going to stop you for just a sec. I don't understand how this happens. My insurance company will pay the same providers the appropriate amount to cover the care and, you know, a little bit more for the business side of it, right? That's what my insurance company does, presumably. Well, all Medicaid is, isn't it just an insurance company for people without insurance? And yet, why aren't the rates the same as what my insurance company is paying?
Because the state of Washington has decided to underpay that. And the real inequity of that, Tracy, is the fact that, I'll give you a for instance, there's a hospital in the state of Washington, and that hospital is a community hospital. It's a public health district. 70% of their clientele are Medicaid, Medicare, Indian Health. That leaves 30% that are private payers. So Medicare and Indian Health are at least relatively close to the cost of providing that care. Medicaid is way below. But in order to make up for those shortfalls of that 70%, which Medicaid is the worst, they're having to charge private insurance 170 or 180% of cost. In other words, overbill private insurance in order to stay in business. So your private health insurance is costing way more to access that care because the state of Washington is underpaying at such a rate.
And insurance companies don't eat that cost. They pass it along to the
rate payers. We wonder why our insurance rates, I mean, we've been digging into this for a couple of years. And when I first heard it, I thought, these numbers aren't right. I mean, the analogy that I give is you get a bunch of people, let's say you got a bunch of your family, goes out for dinner, and your rich uncle decides, oh, I'll pay for it with my card. You just pay cash in for what you got. Well, when he gets the bill, he realizes everybody else in his family underpaid by $5. Well, if there was 20 of them, do the math, all of a sudden he's got to pay an extra $100 for all those cheapskates out there that underpaid. That's what private insurance is doing for Medicaid. You walk in the door of a hospital, they treat you. If they're on Medicaid, they're not going to get paid anywhere near what the cost of treatment was. Well, that hospital, and I live in a world of public hospital, public health districts here in my district. I've got three of them in my district. They aren't rolling in cash. They're tax-funded hospitals, but they're treating Medicaid patients that they aren't getting paid even close to what it costs to treat them. So they've got to access that money from somewhere, and it's typically from your private insurance providers who pass it on to those individuals.
This is The Elephant in the Dome. It's a podcast of the Senate Republican Caucus. Senator Ron Muzzall is with me. We're talking about health care. Seems, and I know nothing in this on this issue is easy, but it seems like at least part of the answer to this quandary is pretty simple. I mean, just increase reimbursement rates. You're the you're a legislator. You're part of a body that can do that. Why not just do that?
Every dollar that we put into it, we get federal matching dollars, but it's got to come from somewhere. And we already spend a tremendous amount of money on Medicaid and Apple Health and all of these for low-income individuals in the state of Washington. But you just came up with the answer. We got to put more money into it. We got to take that from somewhere. We're gonna end up having to take that out of the operating budget. And it has not been a high priority because it's getting done. It's just that we're pushing that off onto the private citizens. It's another tax, essentially. We just don't call it that. But what we've created now is this crescendo of events. We got hundreds of people stuck in hospitals because there's no care centers, rehab centers, or long-term care for them to go into. We've got a shortage of workers because hospitals and long-term care centers can't afford to pay their employees more, and they can make more by going somewhere else. You know, not everybody that works in a hospital or in a long-term care is a nurse or a doctor. We've got a lot of other people, a lot of them specialized, but even janitorial that have to be paid, they can go somewhere else and make more money. So then we've got these staffing shortages. And I hear lots of great ideas out there that, you know, oh, we just need to do this or we just need to do that. But the unintended consequences of those don't solve the basic problem. And that is that the state of Washington has not lived up to its responsibility for those less fortunate. The JLARC study, which was carried out in 2019, estimated that we were $1.4 billion shy of our Medicaid reimbursements. So that was 4 years ago now, and $1.4 billion. Now, remember, we've got federal matching dollars that can come in, and those federal matching dollars offset. But even if you take half of that, that's $700 million. And when I bring this up amongst especially those in the majority on the other side of the aisle, they say, well, we just don't have the money. Well, I don't understand that rationale, because this was a commitment we made to take care of those less fortunate. And we seem to spend hundreds of millions on projects that don't have a direct benefit to the constituents like this does.
Yeah, it seems to me that this would be right in the wheelhouse of our friends on the other side of the aisle, the Democrats. I mean, it's one of the things that they stand on. It's one of their top priorities is to help people who can't help themselves, especially when it comes to healthcare. And at the same time, like you said, it's helping the entire system. It's not just helping these people. So it helps really everyone in the state.
Correct. And I've no end to meetings, but the one thing that I have, and it's in unanimity among the behavioral health community, they continue to tell me, we've got enough behavioral health providers. The reimbursement rates are so low, and it's so complicated and varied across the state that we have behavioral health providers who aren't in the business because they can't make enough money to stay in practice. If we would raise those rates, those Medicaid reimbursement rates, we would have behavioral health providers coming back into the system, providing the behavioral health support that we need to get ahead of our behavioral health crisis. Now, I just got to scratch my head. I'm this big, bad conservative who doesn't care about people, supposedly, if you listen to the narrative, but I feel like the voice in the wilderness crying, this is a simple solution. We just need to step up to the plate.
Do your fellow Republicans on your committee agree? I mean, are Republicans in agreement on this issue that we need to work to do something?
I've brought this up in caucus, brought this up with committee, I've brought this up in caucus. We're in agreement that we are just irresponsible when it comes to our Medicaid reimbursements, and that as a state, I can't believe that we're failing at the rate we are. And if you ask anybody in long-term care, in primary physicians, in the hospital system, in behavioral health, or in substance abuse treatment, they will tell you all in one that Medicaid reimbursement rates are abysmal.
I happen to know there are some Democrats who agree with you out there on your committee even. And this seems like an area where there could be bipartisan cooperation, where you could actually work together to get something done. Is that, will that be possible this session?
Yes, I think that it will be possible. We also have a Medicaid system that probably needs a reboot. Our Medicaid system is antiquated, it's like a bad movie. You know, it's not bad actors. It's really a bad script, and that's what we're dealing with in Medicaid. We've got to bring it up, and we've got to look to simplify it. And I don't think that we need to blow it up and start all over. We just need to reprioritize, but we need to raise these rates. That's the first step. And this will have a ripple effect. This will have a tendency to drive down costs to the private insurance and those, but it'll also affect the access to care, which is so critical right now.
That's Senator Ron Muzzall, and this is The Elephant in the Dome, the official podcast of the Senate Republican Caucus.